Hey, I'm Sam from Prismic. I'm here with Delba from Vercel. Delba, thanks for joining me.
Hi, hello.
How are
Nice to be
you?
here. Thank you for inviting me.
Well, yeah, it's a pleasure. How are you doing today?
I'm doing okay.
Cool. So, to get started, could you tell us all a little bit about what you do at Vercel?
Yeah, sure. So I work as a developer advocate at Vercel.
Okay.
So my job is to help developers and teach them how to use React and Next.js and also how to deploy to Vercel.
Really cool. Really cool. So, you help developers with like learning like complex new technologies, and people coming from all sorts of different levels of knowledge. And today we're going to talk a little bit about different paths for learning web development, which is really exciting because there's so many people learning web development right now. It's such a huge field and huge opportunities, especially with React and Next.js, which are two of the most popular and fastest growing web frameworks. So, what would you say are some of the main paths for learning web development today?
Yeah, so I think there are probably three main paths
Okay.
to learning web development. There's the traditional path, which is university, doing a computer science degree. There's also boot camps, which is what I did, and I believe that you
Yeah,
did a boot
I
camp
did
as
a boot
well.
camp.
Yeah. And there is the self-taught path, which is probably the hardest because you have to have a lot of, self-discipline. And I think that as, junior developers or people learning how to code, we really need to like research and explore the different paths to see which one, would be a better fit when we
Yeah.
are learning. So I went to a boot camp and I could probably share more of that.
Could we actually go through all of them one by one and talk
Yeah.
about some of the costs and the trade-offs of each one?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, we can.
You mentioned the boot camp, so why don't we start there?
The whole idea of a boot camp is to teach you the in-demand skills that you need to get a job as a developer and to give you as well the opportunity to practice what you're learning. So depending on your boot camp, it can be very practical. So I went to Lambda School and we had a lot of, projects and we worked in teams and we also had like daily feedback on our work so that we knew exactly, the things that we needed to improve on and the things that we still needed to learn. So boot camps are very accelerated and very intense because you do
Yeah.
it in a few short months.
Do you remember how many hours a day you were working during your boot camp?
So the boot camp that I attended was full time, so it was 8 hours a day. But I was the kind of student that needed to do a lot of prep work beforehand. So
Me
for
too.
me as well, yeah, for me it was like something like 10 to 12 hours a day just dedicated
Yeah.
to the boot camp.
Me too.
There were other students there that, had more experience and they could just whiz through it. And there were students that struggled even more. So the thing with boot camps is that because they're very accelerated, they are kind of like a one hand fits all solution. So you really need to make sure that if you are going to commit to a boot camp, because it's both a time and a financial investment, you need to make sure that you can keep up with the work and like understand how much work you have to put in order to be successful in the boot camp.
One thing that I get concerned about with boot camps is that people expect that they will just kind of like enroll in the boot camp and then automatically learn things. But in my perspective, it's re you really have to be driven and committed because it is. Mine was 10 weeks long. And it's a very intense experience, and you have to be willing to work very, very hard for 10 weeks.
Yes, that's right. You have to, like I used to say to the students there, because I briefly worked as well with the students, is that what you're doing when you're joining a boot camp is you're making a short-term sacrifice for long-term rewards. So you're investing, like you're focusing and investing your time now so that you can reap the benefits later. And I
Yeah.
think that's what boot camps are. The thing with boot camps as well is that, as you mentioned, people go in expecting to kind of just absorb the knowledge and learn, and that's not the case
No.
at all. So I really like whenever people ask if they should join a boot camp like Lambda School, I always tell them to do their research, to, you know, look at the curriculum, look at the schedule, look at the kind of support they're expected to receive, and look at all the different things that they will be doing during those, you know, very short, intense weeks, because it's not for everyone. Mm-hmm. Like, their teaching style might not match your style. So it's very important to do any free courses that they have available and code beforehand.
Yeah.
I personally wouldn't join university or bootcamp without coding first, because I think that you need to know whether you like coding before you make the commitment.
You mentioned that bootcamps are a good way to learn practical in-demand skills. Can you say a little bit more what you mean about that?
So the thing with university is that they teach you the foundations of computer science. And a lot of degrees, at least in the UK, they also teach specialization. So you do the foundations for like 2 years, and then you specialize in web development, data science in your last year. And bootcamps, they kind of remove the foundations of computer science, and they only teach you the skills that you need to get a job, depending on the job market. So, for example, for my bootcamp, I learned front-end and back-end, and it was with a heavy focus on React, because React is, you know, the most in-demand framework at the moment. And I feel like I was given a solid foundation to be able to build applications. But there's a lot of stuff that, you know, was left out, because they have to skip over a lot of the, you know, foundational computer science concepts in order to get you to the place where you can get hired.
Yeah, it's a big difference. I was talking to a friend studying computer science, and he's explaining, you know, C and binary, and I'm talking about using NPM and Node.
Yeah.
And we really had to like completely explain those concepts to each other because neither of us had studied the other at all.
I agree. And the thing with computer science is that you can spend your life learning it, because there's just so many different topics and different specializations. And I think that the university route would be great for people who don't know if they want to specialize yet. Because a bootcamp, when you go to a bootcamp, you're making the decision that you're going to specialize in web development or data science or, you know. But with a degree, it's like you're getting an overview of things first before you specialize. Let's talk about university.
Yeah. What are some of the benefits and trade-offs of a university degree?
Yeah. So before joining a bootcamp, I was interested in going to university because I think that it's really good to have a foundation, a computer science foundation. But the problem with university is that you have to make a huge investment. Not as much as, you know, America, but still it's a huge investment here for us in Europe as well. So, and there is no guarantee that you will get a job at the end. But for people who are more academically minded, I think it's a great option, because then you get to explore like the intricacies of computer science and programming. And what I like to say is that you can always learn those things. It's never too late, but you don't necessarily need to have a degree to be a developer. So for people who are really interested in the subject, I think it's a great option.
How do you think a university degree might help somebody in their career?
I think it really does depend on where you want to go in your career, because there are many different paths within tech itself. Like as we've as we've learned, you could be a developer advocate, or you can work in documentation. You can specialize as a product engineer, or you can work on programming tools. So there's lots of different paths. And I think that apart from gaining that knowledge that you get from, you know, doing a degree, that knowledge would probably be helpful if you want to go more into an academic route, like, for example, teaching. Or I have a friend who is currently doing a PhD in computer science. And he's specializing in making the web more accessible. So you can really dive deep into certain areas of specific topics.
If you really want to specialize
somewhere deep. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, okay. And then the third path that you mentioned is self-teaching.
Yes.
Okay. So mm-hmm. what are some of the costs and benefits? I mean, the mm-hmm. Trade-offs and benefits of self-teaching.
Yeah. So with self-teaching, I think that it requires a lot of discipline and also letting go of, you know, the kind of like structured way we're used to learning. So the reason why I chose a bootcamp was because when I was learning to code by myself, I really struggled with knowing what to learn next. Like as a beginner, it's really hard for you to know what to focus on. And you can get stuck in rabbit holes a lot, like especially with JavaScript. So I think that if you're self-teaching, you kind of have to realize that it's okay not to have that structure. And you also need to be very aware of how you learn and the different learning methods available. Like, for example, we create content for the developer community, but a lot of the content that we create is passive. So we're creating docs and articles and videos. If you're learning in a passive way, there's just, I think, so much that you can absorb. And what you really want to do if you're self-taught is not get stuck into, you know, the rabbit holes of tutorials and things like that. Mm-hmm. You want to make sure that you're also doing active learning, mm-hmm. which is building, teaching, experimenting, tinkering. And I don't know how you feel, but I feel like I learn best when I'm building something. Like I can really understand a concept after playing around with something. So you need to keep that in mind and also make yourself like the different learning techniques that we have available to us. For example, spaced repetition. Do you know about spaced repetition?
No, I do not. What is spaced repetition?
Okay, so spaced repetition is when you expose yourself to a topic in many different ways and also at different timed like intervals until that topic becomes clear in your mind. So just to give you an example, there was an article that Guillermo wrote for the staff of Vercel, which talked about Next.js at the edge. And that article, the first time I read it, it was like within 2 weeks of joining Vercel, I probably understood like 20% of it because of how technical it was. But as time went by and I was exposed to, you know, different things within Vercel, I reread that article again and again, and I've probably read it like 5 times already, but now I feel like I can fully understand everything that's on that article.
Wow.
Because, you know, of the exposure that I've had. So when you don't understand a topic as a developer, it's always good to just pause, you know, take a break from it and then come back and then like try to relearn it until that topic becomes clear.
I love that idea, especially with an article or maybe like a tutorial or a course or something of like actually reading it in full, putting it aside, come back a week or 2 weeks or a month later and you'll see how like you actually did learn some of those concepts there, or like they helped you create a foundation so that you could learn bits and pieces.
I
definitely see that in my job because, you know, I joined this company that has an entire product with different features and options and configurations. So I've watched for myself the experience of learning those features and building things on each other, you know, and the way things connect gradually over time to create a fuller picture. It's a really cool process.
Yeah, it is. It is. And kind of related to that is the Feynman technique. You know, Richard Feynman. I'm sure I'm mispronouncing his surname, but he was a physicist, and he said that the best way to kind of learn something is to teach it. So when you expose yourself to a concept, you try to explain that concept to yourself or to others, and you just repeat that kind of same cycle of learning and teaching until mm-hmm. you're so sure that you know a subject so well that you can take it apart and then put it together in different ways mm-hmm. for different audiences, and it makes sense.
Yeah.
And you see that with like very talented developers who really know their craft. They will be able to just kind of like open a box in their brain and just spill out information mm-hmm. and they can adapt it to different audiences. So that's another way that you could learn as a developer as well. It's just by teaching it until you're confident that you know that topic.
Yeah. Especially yeah. with if you're self-taught, this is something that I see a lot of developers doing is mm-hmm. Like blogging or sharing what they learn somehow, maybe on Twitter.
Mm-hmm.
If I remember correctly, you did a little bit of this, right?
Yeah, more or less, yeah.
Is that what you call learning in public?
Yes, yes. I think that term was coined by Swix.
Okay. Cool.
And it's the idea that, you know, as you're learning, you're sharing it mm-hmm. with the public and contributing to the developer community.
Yeah, which is really cool. It's because it is, like as you said, it's a great way to learn, just like as you're taking in a concept to write a draft of a blog post. Mm-hmm. And then you're thinking about, like, do I understand this well enough that I can explain it to somebody else? And then at the end, you have like a blog post that you can publish mm-hmm. and share with other people to help them learn the same concept.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. And I guess kind of related to that with sharing with other people, one thing that you don't get automatically when you are self-taught is a community. Because mm-hmm. in a bootcamp in university, you have, you know, your colleagues, your teammates, and you can share knowledge with each other, especially when you're working on a project together. But if you're self-taught, you don't automatically get that community. So I think it's very important to make a conscious decision to find a community, whether mm-hmm. that's on Twitter or, you know, like Discord or Reddit or whatever, and share your knowledge, but also learn from others as well. And that's what I see a lot with, you know, these online developer communities, is that you discover a lot of things just by following people and engaging with them. And that's another way you could learn.
Yeah, definitely. So I noticed that a mm-hmm. lot of developers ask the question, what's mm-hmm. the best way to learn web development? Yeah. What do you think of that question?
Yeah, I think that question can lead to a lot of biases mm-hmm. Because as developers, we've learned a certain way. So we think that the way we've learned is best, and that's the way we want to recommend to people. And when it comes to learning itself, code is a huge time investment. You have to put in a lot of time to become a good software engineer. And in some cases, it's also a huge financial investment because you're having to pay for your education. So I think that it's important to do your research. And when I say research, I mean, look at the different, if you're thinking about university or bootcamp, look at the different like programs, their teaching styles. If you feel like you can self-teach, I recommend like starting out with that first and then making the decision to change if you want to afterwards, just to make sure that first you're comfortable with coding, like you're happy that that's the thing that you want to do as a profession. And second, just to make sure that your learning style matches whatever path you take. So I think it's very important to just follow your intuition and do your research. Mm-hmm. And yes, developers will try to give you advice. We always like to give advice. But at the end of the day, it's up to you to decide what path you want to take and not be discouraged by what other people say about self-taught bootcamp university. Because it's I guess it's a very individual thing.
Yeah, yeah. Such good advice, because there are so many different paths that you mm-hmm. can take.
Yeah.
And what we're going to talk about next mm-hmm. is actually, once you've learned web development, once you've gotten pretty comfortable with it, we're going to talk about how you can actually start looking for a job as a web developer. And Delba, I think you've got a lot of interesting things to say about that. So I'm looking forward to that conversation.
mm-hmm. Thank you.